This is my room. It's the body. I'm just, is it recording? Yeah. It's the room, it's just a body. I'm just setting up at the moment. And this is like my thing where my performance is gonna be. Waiting for Dinah, here's her costume. I don't need this chair, so this chair needs to go. But yeah, it's all coming together now to see my lighting. And here is Aisha giving me company. I had candles now. These napkins, Dinah got me their big candles. No flower, obviously, in the workhouse. This one looks so clear and creepy. This is it from this view. Peek through. Like Dinah will be. And then this is my costume. My costume's all wrapped up at the moment for protection. I'm so happy.
Look beyond the surface. And maybe you will see what you do not expect to see. We as people behave as people expect us to behave. We say what people expect us to say, and we do what people expect us to do. Not really thinking how we feel. Take a look at me. What do you see? You only see what's on the surface. You only see what I choose to show you. Look again. Take another look. What do you see now? Probably something you did not expect. Everybody has secrets. Everybody does. And every story has two sides to it. Yes, every story has two sides to it. Everybody has a story which you know nothing about. Everybody has a story. But the emotional journey that I've been on, the love I have felt, the hurt I have felt, the decisions that have been made for me and the decisions I have made for myself, all make me part of who I am today. Here in this place, I met him, the love of my life. We saw each other through the window. And the rest is history. We married and had a happy life. Had I have not fallen pregnant whilst working at the manor as a maid and been sent here, I would never have met him. And I love him very much. But the love I have for him has no comparison to the love I feel for my baby, for my child, my little girl, my little Rose. She is my whole world. She will never know who her real father is, but she will always know that her mother loves her very much.
No. Once a week, that's all I get in here. Oh, you've got a kind face, sir. You spare a few coppers. Pen of the gin, keep the cold out. Nothing. How with you then? What are you looking at? The price to pay for looking. That's my boy, that must be, he must be in there. Sir, are you there?
You can follow me into here. Don't be afraid to come and step on the boxes. Come to me.
To make want of chastity on a woman's part the shortest road to obtaining either a husband or a competent maintenance, and to encourage extortion and perjury. It would be impossible for the heart of man or demon to devise a more effective instrument for extinguishing every noble feeling in the female heart, for blighting them with their affections,
degrading
the males and females of that portion of
community
connected with the receipt of paraphernalia.
Pride.
And the practice of the laws relative to bastardy.
I lost their father. Oh, we weren't wed.
The man may not
be abandoned us.
As guilty as the woman. And it may seem hard or unjust to punish her.
No love.
The weaker and more helpless of the two.
No money, I lost my home.
Go unpunished.
Well, I'm still a mother.
The penal law is to repress.
How can you be a mother if you haven't got a home?
Punishment is a means to an end. The end is the prevention of crime.
I have nowhere else to go. He must be here somewhere. In the house, they're safe, my children. Got a roof over their heads and food and warm clothes. They ain't got their mummy! They separated us. I only see them maybe once a week. That's the price I had to pay. It's not enough. I need more.
Where's mummy's breakfast? He asked me, all blue eyes and 2-year-old concern. And I told him I'm not hungry. There's an oil paint in my stomach called me a liar. But what else can you do when you've turned your heating off? In November 2011, it went off at the mains and I put my furniture in front of it. Don't forget that it was ever there to alleviate the temptation to turn it on and let it lift even more money that I didn't have to get the way down the drain. You turn everything off at the wall sockets, including the fridge. You've become obsessed with dark painting things. There's not even a little green LCD light that you're asking you.
With the house.
Taking money away.
Not me.
You don't go without things. You're on school, you're like.
I'm lost.
You stop getting your hair cut.
I've fallen.
You turn the water off. You give some shallow bath.
Shame.
Water boil from the kettle.
I have to carry the guilt.
But property isn't just having no heating.
I'm all alone.
Property isn't just not having quite enough food.
That's the price I've had to pay.
Poverty is that feeling when your small boy finishes his 1 week's bit, mashed up with a little bit of cold water, and he looks at you and he says, "Have some more, please, mummy. More bread and jam, please, mummy."
I need more.
Is he wondering how to carry the guitar and the TV to the boy?
Oh, I'm falling apart.
And for 2 years, it's no bread and jam. What's that one right?
You in here, son. You in here.
Not for me. Home was never. never under this roof, between these walls, through that window. I never felt at home sat on chair by that hearth, or in kitchen, or dormitories. This was never my own. I remember the day they came for me and my brother William. William, he were 8. I was only 4. He was a good brother, was William. He were kind and used to play with me. He was good at finding food too, because we never had enough to eat. Used to go begging from neighbours. We'd sit by our front floor. We had no furniture, it was all broken. We never had fire, never enough money. Marsh, she'd be up early, before first light, and she'd be out working till long after dark. Pa, he worked away, sent money back what he could. Remember that day? The day they came for us. But knock at door. A man came in. We knew him. We'd seen him before. He was kind. He used to bring us food. But today we're different. He was there and we were talking. Talking to Ma, and she started to cry. And Pa, he were angry. He was so angry. Man, he turned to William and to me and he said, say your goodbyes now. He brought us here. I remember the building seemed so big it went right up into sky. And a voice, it was a kindly voice, a voice said to me, give your brother up. So I did. And I clung on to him, and he clung on to me, and we wouldn't let go. In the end, they had to pick me up, and they had to fight with William. And looking over his shoulder as they took me away, I could see him kicking and screaming and crying. That was the last time I ever saw William. Took me away, they did, and cut off all my hair. Vermin, they said. And they scrubbed me from head to toe till I was red raw and put me in uniform that was all itchy and scratchy. But family did it. Food would be good. Big fluffy potatoes. Lots of food. But routine of work, work, work. Rules and work. Lots of rules. But worse things. Worst thing but nights. Nights in dormitory. Sharing bed with strangers. 2-3 of us took bed. It was so dark. And I was scared at dark. And no William. I looked for him everywhere. Through windows. Out in the yard. I looked in the garden. I hoped to see him in schoolroom. I'll never forget this place. I could leave workhouse. It will never leave me. Home is where work. Home is where the heart is, they say. Home's not here. Not for me.
Here. How was I brought so low? Look, look at me. See this A? A for adultery. They call me adulteress. Make me wear this A for all the world to know that I lived with a married man. His wife couldn't leave him, though the marriage was long over. My sweetheart, he died. I was left with nothing.
No money, no home, no hope, no love. Forced to come into this place, to be incarcerated in this cell. Punished by having to wear this A. Do you know what some of the punishments in this workhouse are? For answering matron back, no supper. For running away, no meat for a week. For singing, 2 hours in this place. Oh yes, we are allowed to sing hymns, but there are other songs. Songs about people like me, the unknown people, people who've been forced to come to this place through no fault of their own. Ones like Sarah. This is her song. My name is Sarah Goshen. You won't have heard of me. I'm good at sewing seams. I always had the knack. But if God didn't want me a harlot, he wouldn't have put me on me back. There's really no hope for the likes of me. Look at what they've done. Branded me with this A. They attack me. My face is scarred. My body is bruised from the beatings. Oh, not from Master. He wouldn't dare. From the other women. They hate women like us. The harlots. The scarlet women. I'm ruined. I'm fading. I'm cold. I want to be with my sweetheart, but I lack the strength. Shall I go? See this boy? This pauper boy? He found a way out. I heard the rumours. They say he took laudanum, stole it from the master's office, drank it swiftly. Poor boy. He must have suffered agonies. But now, he's free. I want to be free too. Help me! What can I do? My name is Kitty Bray. You won't have heard of me. I had a sweetheart once. I loved him as a wife. He is dead and I am forsaken. A poor adulteress with no life. There's really no
You get very absorbed in my tea making. Tea is very important to me. I didn't see you come in. I've been asked to tell you something about my life. So, I have here a little verse to read you. Tea is the life of me. It's in my blood. Echoed through these halls, trickling down these stone-cold walls. But you know, places like this aren't really so bad. That's a lesson I learned from my dear old dad. 2 sisters, a brother, a father, and a mother, all scattered across the land, while William and George stood hand in hand, working and learning to ensure they were earning. When they were free, life offered William a cup of opportuna tea. And 1,000 later, Edna, the typist, was sure she could hear someone ripping up paper. She looked around and soon she found the source of that most peculiar sound. He turned to look, and there was she, confused but amused, as he tasted his tea. William knew he'd met the love of his life. The day finally came when he could call her his wife. They became father and mother to my brother and me. So forgive me if I'm fussy about how I brew my tea. It's a sentimental subject. It's the life of me. So if you'll just excuse me before it gets cold.
Sometimes I think I can see him in the distance, and then I remember I cannot. 1940, how the time goes. My name is Marjorie, and I was separated from my husband during the war, that dreadful war. The only communication we had between us were words. These words you see here before you. They were words that spoke of fear and longing and love. Words that were all we had for so long. Words that were contained in letters. Dear Sydney, I'm sorry that not all of my letters reach you. I do try, my darling, but your address changes like the wind. I gave your regards to Ma and Pop and little Nell. They're very well. Everything is well and kneeling. You'd be pleased to know the hens are laying again. We had 4 eggs yesterday. We haven't had any air raids for the last 2 nights. I don't know what the Jerrys are doing. They're keeping away from us. I think our boys are giving them a good run for their money. We haven't heard much from them. A bomb did drop in Brentford last week. We could hear it. We could feel it. But we're fine. We're fine. I do hope you get leave soon. You speak of the hellish cold. The real hell, my dear, is being separated from you. I hope my letters warm you as your letters warm me. Did you get the pullover? And the gloves that I sent you with the last letter? With sleeves and fingers as requested? I'm glad the army is teaching you to wash the pots and pans and dishes and the floors and so forth. That will stand you in good stead when you come home, my darling. And you will come home. I'm quite sure of that. This war cannot go on forever. I look forward to your letters too. I was surprised to see you writing in ink last week. That was very kind of somebody to lend you some. I do hope your writing desk is still not the floor, but at least it will be clean if you have to scrub the house from top to bottom. I can't help thinking of that poor chap who's not received a letter since he's been in the army. Poor man, he must be so lonely. Loneliness is the real devil. When I'm lonely, I read your letters. I've kept all your letters. And I read them out loud. And I can hear your voice. And when I'm really sad and lonely, I look at the ring that you gave to me in church. And I remember those words we said to each other. For better, for worse. I have those words to remind me that we're together, even though we're apart. I'm glad you're sleeping in minutes now. Perhaps you'll get more sleep. Just think, my darling, you can go to bed and dream of me. I go to bed and dream of you every night. I dream that this dreadful war is over. I dream that we're together again. I dream that we have more than words to keep us together. But for now, words are all we have to keep us together. I must close now, my darling. Keep these words close to your heart. Fondest love, Marjorie.
Thank you very much for coming to see our performance at our Southwell workhouse. If you have any questions or would like to look through our work, then please feel free. Thanks.